हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू यूनिट 2, सेकंड लेक्चर, सर्विसेज एंड कंपोनेंट्स ऑफ द ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम, 10 मार्क्स। इन आवर प्रीवियस लेक्चर वी हैव कवर्ड टॉपिक ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम सर्विसेज एंड सिस्टम कॉल्स। टुडे इन दिस लेक्चर वी विल कवर कंपोनेंट्स ऑफ द ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम एंड सिस्टम टूल्स। कंपोनेंट्स ऑफ द ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम। An operating system provides the environment within which the programs are executed. Internally, operating systems vary in their makeup. The goal of the system must be well defined before the design begins. We can create a system as large and complex as an operating system only by partitioning it into smaller pieces. Each piece should be a well-designated portion of the system with a careful defined input, output and function. There are total 5 different components of the operating system. First, process management, main memory management, file management, I/O system management, secondary storage management. We will see process management. A program is a passive entity, such as the content of a file stored on the disk, whereas the process is an active entity with a program counter specifying the next instruction to execute. The execution of a process must be sequential. The CPU executes one instruction of the process after another until the process completes. There may be two processes may be associated with the same program. Thus, they are considered two separate execution sequences. A time-shared user program, such as a compiler, is a process. A word processing program being run by an individual user on a PC is a process. Sending output to the printer is also a process. A process needs certain resources, including CPU time, memory, files, and I/O devices to accomplish the task. These resources are either given to the process when it is created or allocated to it while it is running. A process is a unit of work in the system. Such a system consists of collection of processes, some of which are operating system processes and some are user processes. All these processes can potentially execute concurrently by multiplexing CPU among them. The operating system is responsible for the following activities in connection with the process management: scheduling processes and threads on the CPU, creating and deleting both user and the system processes, suspending and reassuming processes, providing mechanism for process synchronization, providing mechanism for the process communication. Next, main memory management. Main memory is central to the operation of the modern computer system. Main memory is the repository of the quickly accessible data shared by the CPU and I/O devices. The central processor, that is the CPU, reads instruction and data from the main memory during the instruction fetch and data fetch cycle. The I/O operation implemented via DMA, direct memory access, to read and write data in the main memory. CPU is able to address and access the memory directly. CPU, to process data, it must be in main memory. For a program to be executed, it must be mapped to absolute addresses and loaded into main memory. As the program executes, it accesses the program instruction and data from the memory. To improve both CPU utilization and the speed of computer response, we must keep the several programs in the main memory. Many different memory management schemes are available, and the effectiveness of the different algorithm depend on the particular situation. The operating system is responsible for the following activities in connection with the memory management. Keep the track of which part of the memory are currently being used and by whom. Decide which process and the data move into and out of the memory. allocate and deallocate memory space as needed. Next component is file management. It is the most visible component of the operating system. Computer can store information on the magnetic tape, magnetic disk, optical disk. These are the most common media. Each of these media has its own characteristics and physical organization. Each media is controlled by the disk drive and also has a unique characteristics. These characteristics include access speed, capacity, data transfer rate, and access method. For convenient use of the computer, OS provide uniform logical view of information storage. OS define a logical storage unit, a file. OS map files onto physical media and access these files via storage devices. File is the collection of related information defined by the creator. A file consists of sequence of bits, bytes, lines, words, or records whose meaning are defined by their creator. Operating system implements the abstract concept of file by managing mass storage media such as disk, tape, and devices that control them. Files are normally organized into directories to ease their use. The operating system is responsible for the following activities in connection with the file management: creating and deleting file, creating and deleting directories to organize the file, supporting primitives for manipulating files and directories, mapping files on the secondary storage, backup files on the stable, that is non-volatile storage media. Next component is I/O system management. One purpose of an operating system is to hide the peculiarities of the specific hardware device from the user. Only the device driver knows the peculiarities of the specific device to which it is assigned. To start an I/O operation, the CPU loads the appropriate register within the device controller. According to this, device controller determines what action to take. For example, for read request, the controller will start the transfer of the data from the device to its local buffer. Once the I/O is started, two course of actions are possible. In the simplest case, the I/O is started, then the I/O completion, the control is returned to the user process. This case is known as synchronous I/O. The other possibility called as asynchronous I/O. It returns the control to the user program without waiting for the I/O to complete. The I/O then can continue while other system operations occur. In synchronous I/O, CPU may always wait for a I/O completion. A better alternative is to start I/O and then continue processing of the other user program. If no user programs are ready, operating system again has to wait for this. Operating system uses a table containing an entry of each I/O device and the device status table. Each table entry indicates the device type, address, and the state. Operating system is responsible for the following activities: a memory management component that includes buffering, caching, and spooling, a general device driver interface, the drivers for specific hardware devices. Next component is secondary storage management. The main purpose of the computer system is to execute the program. This program must be stored into the main memory during execution. Because the main memory is too small to accommodate all the data and program, and because the data that it holds are lost when the power is lost, that is the main memory is volatile, the computer system must provide secondary storage to back up the main memory. The most modern computer system uses this as the storage media for both program and data. Most programs, including compiler, assembler, sort routines, editors, and formatters, are stored on the disk until loaded into the main memory. Hence, the proper management of the disk storage is of central importance to the computer system. The operating system is responsible for the activities in connection with the disk management, free space management, storage allocation, disk scheduling. Operating system tools. System tools are applications that possess certain functionality and can be used for implementing different tasks. Some system tools are helpful and some might cause a large amount of damage or harm, widespread destruction on your machine. So, operating system tools that we will study are user management, security policy, device management, performance monitor, task scheduler. First, user management. One can easily go to the user and groups pane from the tools. Go to the control panel and there one may find a tab user account. There a user account can be created and the profile picture or the password can be managed easily. One can even have numerous user accounts enabled to operate at different mode in the computer. Even one can given an access to the computer by making the guest account enabled in the password protected computer. One user cannot see or access the files or settings of the another user until he or she is set as administrator. One administrator alone can have access to view or manage all other users' details. There is yet another option in users and groups to function at the same time. The option is the group profile, where there will be a group ID and group password, which can be accessed by entire group. Next tool is security policy. This is a feature for the large corporate and is in ultimate version of the Windows operating system. This feature will not be seen in the home computers. One can find the local security under the administrative tools, which one may get access from the control panel. This option allows the administrator to provide access or deny access to some users, to some drive or the software on those drives. Thus, the changes in those software or drives will not be possible for them whom the access to the changes or configure it is given by the administrator. By this end user policy, one administrator can allow or disallow any user on those computer to get an access over the few website or not. By this, the user can also be restricted to surf freely at their workplace, at most of the irrelevant website. Basically, irrelevant website to the job will not be open from there. Device manager. When an external hardware is connected to the computer, then the device will be shown at the device manager tray or the administrative window. The hardware may be of various types, like printer, the USB ported devices like pen drive, a tablet or mobile, a mouse, a keyboard or even a camera. Most of the time, the computer detects the drivers of the device and installation of the driver is done instantly and automatically. However, there are many devices which are to be installed separately, like modems or the network devices, and sometimes the device is to be added manually from the Add Device option in the Device Manager tool. Once the device is shown at the Device Manager windows, then the device can be configured or even troubleshooting of the device is also applicable. One can go to the Device Manager pane from the tools directly or even can go via the control panel. At the category view in the control panel, one can find the three options to go to the device manager window. The options are view device and printers, add a device, and adjust commonly used mobility setting. Next, performance monitor. It is the option to actually monitor how the CPU is performing. One can go there from the control panel, or another easy way to reach there is by pressing sticky keys on the keyboard. One can press Ctrl to delete at the same time to find the option of the start task manager. User can go to the fourth tab under the performance, and there they can find the two graphs. One is showing the CPU usage and the other is showing the memory. One may find that all the data are changing there randomly, which implicit the fact that those are the live records of the users and memory. One may find there is a small window, a button called resource monitor. By clicking there, a new larger window will open where there will be a four continuously running meters. The meters are of CPU, memory, network and disk. Thus all the records are placed in front one's eye, and thus making the performance monitoring easy. Task scheduler. Windows can perform a task at scheduled time and a scheduled date. Not only one time does it work, but the Windows can do a particular task schedule every day at a particular time or at a particular interval. One can find the task scheduler by going to the tools. From the tools, one has to go to the control panel. From the control panel, he or she has to go to the administrative tools to find the task scheduler. Thus, it makes the Windows user equipped with the best scheduler, and that also without the support of any other software. Now we will see how these tools are used in the Windows. So we will go to the control panel. For first user management, we will click to the user accounts. Here, add and remove users. Here in this particular system, I have two users. First is the administrator and the second one is the guest user. Okay, so guest user account is off. Now here in administrator, we can have different options. Change the account name, create the password, change the picture, set a parental control, change the account type and manage the other account. Now here, the first one is the change account name. If you want to change this admin account name, you can change from here. You just type it here and click the change name button. After that, there is the create a password option. Here you can write the password and rewrite the same password, and hint question, you may have a hint question, and after that you can click this create password button. Okay, next is the change the picture. Here you can select any picture, so that will be applicable to your user. Okay, now suppose I want to create a new user. I can create it by pressing the create user option. Here I can create two different types of user, standard user and administrator. Standard user account users can use most software and change the system setting that do not affect other user or the security of the computer. Administrator user. Administrator have complete access to the computer and can make any desired changes. Based on the notification setting, administrator may be asked to provide their password or confirmation before making changes that affect other users. Now, in one system, there can be only one administrator user and others can be standard user. So, this is all about the user account. Now, we will see device security policy. Actually, the security policy, this is not applicable for the home computers. It is used in the networks. Okay. So, we can have just the local security option. With that, we can set the IP address of the system. After that, there is the device management. Suppose I will click here, the system and the security. From here, I have the device manager. In case of device manager, it will display all the devices that are currently connected to your system. Now, it may happen that if you will connect any device and that device will not be recognized automatically. At that time, you can add that device from this device manager tool. Okay. Now, the next one is performance monitor. For performance monitor, you are required to click on the start and write there performance monitor. Here the performance monitor option is available. From here, the user can use the performance monitor to view the performance data either in real time or from the log file. For that, we will require to use the resource monitor. Okay, so this resource monitor lets us to view the detailed real-time information about the hardware resources like CPU, disk, network and memory, and the system resources including handles and modules in use by the operating system, services and running application. In addition, you can use resource monitor to stop process start and stop services, analyze process deadlock and view the threads wait chain, and identify processes locking files. Now suppose I will click here on the open resource monitor. Here these are all the individual resources performance will be displayed. Now suppose I will click here the overview. Here all these performance will be displayed. So it will display the number of processes which are currently executing in the system with their PID, that is process identification number, the file name where it is that process is stored, and the read and write and the total bytes, and also the IO priority of the process execution. After that, the network is also having the same one, the number of processes, and the last one is the memory. So memory, again it is having the processes which are executing for the memory. Now overview includes all these four. Means the first there will be CPU, after that the disk, memory and the network. Now suppose you want to see individually performance, here all these four performance will be displayed at once. Okay, so this is the performance for CPU, this is the performance for the disk, this is the network performance and this is the memory performance. Okay, now here individually if you want to check the CPU, here it will display the processes which are running and suspended for the current event for the CPU. Now the services which are currently running in the system. After that, associated handles, these are also there. Okay, now you can also stop the execution of this process by right clicking on the status. Suppose you will press here end process, this particular process execution will end. So with this you can end any process execution or any service execution. After that, memory is also giving you the number of processes which are associated with the processes, and here you can see the performance of the memory. This also is there, this activity and the storage utilized for the drives. Okay, after that the network, individually network, the number of processes which are concerned with the network, all are displayed here. Okay, So this is all about the performance. We can check the system current performance using this particular system too. Now the next one is the schedule task, or you can say task scheduler. Here the purpose of the task scheduler is you can use the task scheduler to create and manage the common tasks that your computer will carry out automatically at the time you specify. To begin, click a command in the action menu. Now here, this is the action menu. From here you can perform various tasks. Suppose I will click here the create task. Here, suppose I will write some name to this task. Suppose daily backup. Now I will put a trigger, new. Now these are the options that we are having. One time means only once, daily if we will set it for daily, that means it will start from this today, 23rd June, and at this particular time, this particular event, this particular task will be executing daily. Now here you can change the time. Suppose I want to set it for 4 o'clock. You can set it. Okay, so time can be set for the daily activity. Also weekly, you can have the time setting as well as the day setting on which day you are required to perform that scheduled task. And for monthly also, you are required to set the month and day. Okay, so suppose I will select here daily. So I will say here okay, and this particular trigger will be created. Now the action that is required to be performed. Now I will create here what action to happen at 4 o'clock every day. So the action, suppose I have written that action of backup in one of the backup file. Here this is the backup file with extension bat. I will open that file. So that particular file will be executed here daily. And if I will press OK, this particular trigger and the action will be scheduled according to the time daily. Okay, so this is all about the task scheduling. So we have learned 5 different system tools: user management, security policy, device management, performance monitor, and task scheduling. So we will